The story I want to tell you is about three, it might sound like a joke actually, it's about three doctors, three surgeons. And these three surgeons, one of them's a Tory surgeon, one of them's a Lib Dem surgeon, and one of them's a Labour surgeon. And the Tory surgeon gets the scalpel out and sharpens it and gets it ready and says, I'm going to have radical surgery. This is the only cure for the patient is radical surgery. I'm going to cut deep and I'm going to cut with this really sharp scalpel. Now the Lib Dem comes in and the surgeon says, well, do you know what? I don't want to do that because I'm not a Tory, I'm a Lib Dem. I want to do it differently. But I'm not really sure that I've necessarily got the skills or really could do it. So I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll mop the brow of the Tory surgeon and I'll help sharpen the scalpel, and that's what I'll do, that'll be my role. And then the Labour surgeon comes in and everyone's very excited when the Labour surgeon comes in. And the Labour surgeon says, well, actually, you know, I'm not going to cut quite as deep. I'm not going to cut quite as fast. But really, I'm still going to use the same sharp scalpel. I'm still going to cause the same amount of pain, but it's going to be over a longer period of time. All those three people know that there's a medicine box just in the corner. And it's a locked cabinet. And in that locked cabinet is a bottle of medicine. And they know that that bottle of medicine is actually the real cure for the patients. All of them know that, but none of them actually open that cabinet and show the patient the actual cure. Everyone in this room knows that there's a cure to austerity. And everyone in this room knows that it isn't about making cuts, that it isn't about attacking the vulnerable, that it isn't about cutting deeper and deeper and deeper and losing people's lives, apart from just losing people's ability to function in life, but losing people's lives. Everyone knows that there's an alternative, but no one's prepared to say it. We know there's a cure, and it's up to us as activists not only to shout loud about that cure and to tell people what it is, that there are alternatives, that there are lots of alternatives. How about taxing the people who aren't paying the taxes at the top of society? There's the cures. There's lots of cures. But the cure isn't about attacking the people who can least afford to pay for the crisis that was caused by the casino capitalists.
One of the really desperate things is the introduction of the universal credit and the fact that you can only apply for it online. How can those people who desperately need the five most claimed credits in the country be forced to apply for them online? These people, they don't have broadband in their houses. They don't have computers to do that. It is a naked attempt to stop the most needy people from claiming the help that they need. We've seen the removal of the EMA, and that means that loads and loads of people, and it's absolutely blatant to our members, are not staying on at school over 16 because they can't afford to do it. And that's taking away not just their life chances, but it's taking away the benefits that they might give to society in the future as well. And even if young people get beyond that, the increase in tuition fees we've seen this year has absolutely slashed the number of people who are applying for university places. And again, not just affecting the achievement of young people, but affecting the things that they're going to do for society in the future. So the Tories are not just dismantling the welfare benefit system, they're not just dismantling the NHS, but they are dismantling the state education system as well. They're giving away, they're not even selling our schools, they're giving them away to any business that wants to run a school. Doesn't matter if they have no previous interest in education, they don't have to put any money in. All they've got to do is say, actually, we'd like to run a school. And they can pretty much do it.
So in the 1970s, things changed again and the political tides turned in another direction. And the project of massive deregulation of the financial sector, cutting back on public spending, lowering taxes for the rich, reducing trade barriers and privatisation got underway. And the economic policies that we see today are the offspring of that different economic approach that launched in the 1970s that some people called neoliberalism. So we can see that the fate of our economy and the fate of all of us is very much the result of political decision making by our politicians, and not merely the result of mysterious financial instruments or the movements of the market. So when people talk about the causes of the financial crisis, they talk a lot about greedy banks and about these mechanisms that were created and financial products that were created that threw the market off. But I think it's also important to see that those things were allowed to happen by the policies that our government put forward, and that they created the scene for the crisis to happen. So whilst they're responsible for the political decisions they're making around austerity, they like to pretend that they didn't have a choice in the run-up to that either, when actually they were very much involved in setting the scene for what happened. So the political decision to implement austerity during a recession has failed repeatedly throughout history and around the world, and I'll just give a couple of quick examples. So as I said, Jubilee Debt Campaign was set up to work on debts in the Global South, and this issue started after a flood of lending to the Global South in the 70s, which plunged a lot of countries who were already impoverished into a huge debt crisis. And the global response for this was for the IMF and the World Bank to push these struggling countries to accept new loans or bailouts, which ensured that they could keep paying off the loans that they originally took out, or which were originally pushed on them by richer countries. So these loans were given in exchange, the new loans from the IMF and World Bank were given in exchange for promises to implement structural adjustment programmes, which included austerity, privatisation and deregulation. And obviously this sounds like a familiar story to us now, especially when we think of places like Greece. And the consequences also sound familiar. Between 1980 and 2000, growth per person was minus 0.5% in Latin America and minus 1.5% in Africa. Poverty soared and economies contracted, but the banks continued to get bailed out. So I'm raising this example to show the similarities of something that's happened before. And this debt crisis was followed then by the 1994 Mexican crisis, the Asian financial crisis in 97, the Brazilian and Russian crises in 98, and the Argentinian crisis of 2002. And in all of these cases, austerity was forced on these countries. Economies shrank and poverty and inequality rose. These were policies which were never voted for by people in these countries. And we're seeing this pattern repeat again today. Time and time again, democracy's been undermined by the supposedly incontrovenable law that you must pay your debts, even if those debts arose from irresponsible lending by profit-driven banks. And even if paying those debts will raise poverty, you're told that economic chaos will follow, so you have to pay them no matter what. But this in itself has been shown to be untrue. You can look to the examples of default in Argentina and the example of what Iceland did in terms of not bailing out some of the banks which their creditors would have wanted to. But if this model has been shown to fail again and again around the world and throughout history, then why does our government keep on using it?
I was invited to a meeting from the African Caribbean Mental Health Service in Manchester. And they spoke to me regarding their service and to the fact that they were created 20 years ago in order to make sure that the African Caribbean people of Manchester community had a service in terms of mental health which catered to the African Caribbean community. And so they were created 20 years ago, and they had to campaign really hard about that for that service. And when I met them in February, they said to me that as a coalition, you need to take the word black out of your organisation because it will exclude a lot of people. So I'm thinking, as a black organisation, you should understand when we say black, we mean it politically, we include everybody. Then they said you have to take the word activist out because you sound too militant. And I'm thinking, okay. And then they asked me, well, have you got councillors on board? And I'm like, well, no, because it's the councillors that are voting through the courts, regardless of the fact that we live in Manchester and we have a Labour-led government, but these councillors are still putting through the courts. And they said, well, if you haven't got councillors on board, then you're not going to get anywhere because people won't listen to you. And it's like, well, that's what the councillors, that's what the authorities want you to think. That's the mindset that we've grown into. That if the politicians don't back you, then you're nobody, and people won't listen to you. And I found this really puzzling because before they actually said that, They told me that they'd been going for 20 years. They'd recently had to close 4 out of the 5 centres because they've had all the funding from national government cut. And they also had a big proportion of their funding from local government cut. I was sat in a room with about 9 staff. They said they're down now to skeleton staff. This is the only staff that we've got left in our organisation. And then they said, we don't think we're going to be around in the next 18 months. And I'm thinking, I'm sat here with an organisation that was built out of campaigning for a particular service, for a particular section of the community. You've had your funding cut. You've had your funding cut from local authority. You've had to close 4 out of your 5 centres, and you don't think you're going to be around for the next 18 months, but you want to be quiet because you think that you can survive after this. It's absolute ridiculous. And this is not just particular to the African Caribbean Mental Health Service. Most voluntary groups, community and community organisations that you find in, you know, in communities. There's this massive fear factor that if we come out and we stand by people that are protesting, then we're going to get the rest of our funding cut. But I'm saying, what have you got to lose, really? What is it that you've got to lose?
Even before austerity, and disabled people in this country, the government's own figures say around 20% of the population is disabled. That's a significant group of people. Disabled people in the UK are more than twice as likely to be living below the poverty line as non-disabled people. That's before austerity. And the 27 countries who are members of the European Union, only 4 have a higher percentage of their disabled community living below the poverty line than is the case in the UK, despite the fact that the UK is one of the richest countries in the European Union. Already before the attacks that we face, disabled people are in a significantly disadvantaged position as far as the UK is concerned. And that is a situation that is set to get worse. Employment amongst disabled people has never gone above the 50% mark. Of those disabled people of working age are in employment, the vast majority work in the public sector. The attacks on the public sector are going to lead to a significant increase in unemployment amongst disabled people and the poverty that is a consequence of unemployment. The attack on incapacity benefit is actually quite shocking. Tens of thousands of people are being thrown off disability work-related benefits by a private company, Atos, that's been given £500 million by the government to run what's called the Work Capability Assessment. The Work Capability Assessment, which is run by this private company, has led to people with terminal cancer being told they are fit for work. And the Work Capability Assessment itself is quite an interesting thing, actually, because it's based on a theoretical model of disability called the biopsychosocial model. I won't go into that, but what's interesting about it is that it's put forward by a bloke called Professor Mansell Aylward, and this is where it does get interesting. Professor Mansell Aylward, who runs an institute for research into these kinds of things at Cardiff University, in his previous life was the chief medical officer of the Department of Work and Pensions. And not only that, but the institute which he runs at Cardiff University is funded by Unum. Who are Unum? Unum are a private insurance company based in the US who the Supreme Court of the United States described as a disability denial factory. And of course, Unum are very interested in the insurance market in the UK because actually, if you want health in future, if this lot get away with it, you're going to need health insurance.
At the moment, we have an average pay gap between women and men in the UK of 14.9%. It's never been any lower than that. We've had equalities legislation that is supposed to guarantee equal pay between men and women for 42 years now, and we've never managed to get it any lower than 14.9%. But for the first time this year, the chief executive of the Fawcett Society, which is one of the oldest campaigning groups for gender equality in the world, Kerry Goddard has said that, that we're in grave danger of this gap actually widening for the first time ever. Up until the end of the financial year 2011-12, women's unemployment saw a 24-year high, and the women's unemployment rate went up by 18%, compared with the men's rate going up by just 0.3%. In a lot of urban areas, that's a, you know, it's not telling the full story because women, men's unemployment was already higher than women's. But then we don't count a lot of women in those unemployment figures because we call them housewives, we call them mothers, we call them people who choose not to work. These are people, as far as I'm concerned, who work. They do reproductive labour in the home that we do not dignify as work. We call it, you know, what women are supposed to do. You know, that's the role of women. And this is the Tories' agenda. The Tories have brought in this universal tax credit, which has already been mentioned by various people. The ideology that underpins this credit is sexist. It supports a traditional model of a family with a man and a woman, a white man and a woman, with two well-behaved children who go to an academy school. That is what this model underpins. You know, and it takes away credits going into the pockets of mothers. It goes to the main wage earner. It takes away credits from families where there are two earners, and gives back to women who do mini jobs or who don't work, who are traditional housewives. But then it gives it to their partners, not to them. So women who are in violent relationships are prevented from leaving those relationships yet again. What we're seeing now with this campaign is a lot of people who've never been involved in political activism before, women who've worked in counselling, who've worked for years counselling survivors of sexual and domestic violence, who've been working away within a system and struggling with the problems within that system, they're starting to realise, and they're having their political consciousness raised, really, to use a slightly old-fashioned term. They're realising that, you know, the system is not working against them, and all of the problems that they've been trying to work around, they could actually change if they started thinking in a slightly different way, and if they devoted some of their time to bringing the political fight to the people who are trying to destroy those services.
That uniting is going to be central to fighting back. And this conference is both about uniting and it is going to be about fighting back.